Hello, welcome to Deeksha Online Mathematics. Lecture 2, Sequence and Series, Straight Lines, JEE Advanced. Okay, let us discuss. What do you mean by sequence? What do you mean by series? What do you mean by progression? Okay, before I start, I want to tell you that I may skip the basic points. I will concentrate on important points. I will concentrate on those points where student may get confusion. There is a chance of forgetting those concepts. I will concentrate. So sequence means, you know, it's a pattern. Series means sum. Sequence means it's a pattern. Series means sum of the sequence. Then what do you mean by progression? A specific pattern. So in progressions, you know that there are some specific patterns are there. Your syllabus mainly will have AP, arithmetic progression, GP, geometric progression, HP, harmonic progression, AGP, arithmetic or geometric progression. Let us see some important points. You know that there will be a common difference. Nth term of that AP will be A plus N minus 1 into D. So if you observe carefully, it will be a linear equation in N. And remember, for AP, SN will be a quadratic in N. So whenever, if you see a quadratic in N for sum, it should be arithmetic progression. And you know that if something, a constant is added to AP, results will be in AP. Subtracted, multiplied, divided, results will be in AP. So all those basic properties you already know. Suppose if you have two numbers A comma B, A comma B comma C, three numbers, let us say, then A, if they are in AP, what is the condition? You know, 2b equal to a plus c. B will be equal to a plus c by 2. This right side, if you observe carefully, in statistics, sum of two numbers divided by 2 is nothing but arithmetic mean of two numbers. So here we call b is the arithmetic mean of a and c if three numbers are in AP. GP. There will be common ratio. That's why Tn will be equal to A into r power n minus 1. Then Sn will be A into r power n minus 1 by r minus 1. Or you can use by taking minus common in the numerator or denominator. For both the formulae, r should not be equal to 1. R should not be equals to 1. If you remember, if mod r is less than 1 and n tends to infinity, r power n tends to 0, then we call that GP as infinite GP. So when r power n tends to 0, sum of that infinite GP will be a by 1 minus r, and r condition is mod r should be less than 1. Then similarly, here also, if I say, if ABC are in GP, B square equal to AC, B will be square root of AC. You know that by statistics, square root of AC is nothing but geometric mean of A and C. So if three numbers are in GP, the middle number is the geometric mean of other two. HP. Suppose if some A1, A2, so on, An are in HP, it implies their reciprocals are in AP. That is the definition of HP. If A1, A2, so on, An are in HP, 1 by A1, 1 by A2, so on, 1 by An are in AP. Suppose if you have ABC which are in HP, then 2 by B will be equal to 1 by A plus 1 by C. We can write this as B equals to 2AC by A plus C. So can we write this as 2 by 1 by A plus 1 by C? If you observe the right side, it is what? It is the reciprocal of arithmetic mean of reciprocals. It is the reciprocal of arithmetic mean of reciprocals of A and C. In statistics, it is called harmonic mean. That's why if ABC are in HP, the middle number B is the harmonic mean of A and C. AGP. Arithmetico geometric progression. So it will be like this: AB. I am writing series. AB. Sorry, A plus. A plus D into BR. A plus 2D into BR square. So on. So where if you observe, first terms will be in arithmetic progression. Second terms B, BR, BR square, they will be in geometric progression. For this series, if you want some of the sum, you should use, you can learn the formula. If you feel formula is big, you can do like this. Let us say that is Sn. Same Sn you can write by shifting and multiply common ratio R to it. Subtract. So 1 minus R into Sn. If you simplify, you will get the formula for Sn as this 1 by R. If you shift that side, A by 1 minus R plus dr into 1 minus r power n minus 1 by 1 minus r whole square minus a plus n minus 1 into d into r power n by 1 minus r. So this is the sum of the AGP formula. Here also you will have sum of infinite AGP, which is same conditions, n tends to infinity, mod r will be less than 1, a by 1 minus r plus dr by 1 minus r whole square. So s infinity you can remember formula, but Sn you apply the procedure, means learn the procedure. So I am repeating the procedure. Whenever you want to calculate sum of n terms of AGP, take it as Sn, multiply with the common difference and shift the terms and then subtract. If you shift the term and subtract, you will get automatically a series will come, which is a GP formula. From that you can develop the sum of n terms of AGP. So arithmetic mean, geometric mean, harmonic mean. Already we discussed arithmetic mean, geometric mean, harmonic mean. But here what I want to tell you, there I told you three terms. Here arithmetic mean, geometric mean, harmonic mean. Arithmetic means, geometric means, harmonic means. Suppose between A and B, if you insert A1, A2, so on, AN, N numbers, so that the resultant is a arithmetic progression. The inserted numbers are called arithmetic means. Between A and B, if you insert N numbers, so that the result becomes a GP, then these are called geometric means. Try to understand arithmetic mean, geometric mean, harmonic mean. There are statistical words. Arithmetic means, geometric means, harmonic means. They are same when there are two numbers, three numbers. Already I discussed. Between A and B, if I insert H1, H2, so on, HN, if it is becomes harmonic progression, the inserted numbers are called harmonic means. So, you can develop here. Suppose if it is AP, this B should be equal to TN plus 2th term of that AP, because A and B are two terms, in between you are inserting N arithmetic means. So, B must be N plus 2th term. N plus 2th term formula should be A plus N plus 1 into D. Then the D value must be B minus A by N plus 1. Means, if between A and B, if you want to insert N arithmetic means, the common difference you have to choose is B minus A by N plus 1. Similarly, if you apply for GP and HP, also you can develop the formulas. Suppose, let us take A, B are two numbers. Then, A plus B by 2 is arithmetic mean. Suppose for three numbers, for N numbers, arithmetic mean means sum of numbers by number of numbers. Suppose if you have two numbers, A plus B by 2, geometric mean will be root AB. Harmonic mean will be 2 by 1 by A plus 1 by B. If you observe carefully, the arithmetic mean, assume arithmetic mean as A, geometric mean as G, harmonic mean as some H. If you observe carefully, there is a relation among themselves. Geometric mean square is equal to product of arithmetic mean and harmonic mean. This says that arithmetic mean, geometric mean, harmonic mean again form a progression which is called geometric progression. And there is an inequality, this is an equality relation, inequality is also there. Arithmetic mean is always greater than or equal to geometric mean, greater than or equal to harmonic mean. So what does it mean? Arithmetic mean is greater than or equal to geometric mean. Means for any two numbers, A and B, they must be positive numbers. Arithmetic mean, minimum value will be its geometric mean. Arithmetic mean, minimum value will be its geometric mean. So, arithmetic mean starts with its geometric mean. Geometric mean starts with the harmonic mean of A and B. If this equality will hold, if the numbers are equal. See, if A and B are equal, what is arithmetic mean? A plus A by 2, A. What is geometric mean? Root of A into A, A. Harmonic mean 2 by 1 by A plus 1 by A, A. Means, arithmetic mean will be equal to geometric mean, equal to harmonic mean if the numbers are equal. These two are very, very important properties. We can use these properties in calculating minimum maximum values. Some special progressions. See, a lot of properties which I am teaching here, which I may skip, but while doing problems, I will use them. Listen concentrately. Some special progressions. Suppose if I take a progression 1, 2, 4, 7. So what are the common difference? 1, 2, 3, then 11, 4, like this. Observe carefully. 1, 2, 4, 7, 11, dash, dash, dash is our progression. So the progressions which we learned are AP, GP, HP, AGP. This belongs to none of them. But if you observe carefully, the differences are in arithmetic progression. If the differences are in arithmetic progression, how to get its TN? So to get its TN, let us take the procedure. SN equal to 1 plus 2 plus 4 plus 7 plus 11, so on TN. Same SN you write by shifting one term. The logic of shifting is, if you subtract, it is nothing but you are making the differences. So left side you will get 0, here 1 you will get 1, 4 minus 2. So it's nothing but 4 minus 2. This 4 minus 2 I am doing here. 4 minus 2, 2. 7 minus 4, 3. 11 minus 7, 4. So on, minus TN. So before, if you put a bracket here, after first term, if you put a bracket, this bracket will contain the differences which you produced here. So, actually by adding 0, I made n plus 1 terms in both the things. When I subtracted, and here 1 is there, here TN is there, in this bracket you should have n minus 1 terms. So 0 equal to 1 plus. So sum of n minus 1 terms. N minus 1 into n by 2 minus TN. So if you shift TN left side, TN will be equal to n into n minus 1 by 2 plus 1. So we got formula for nth term of such special progression. If you and apply SN equal to sigma TN, you will get sum of n terms of that special progression. Similarly, you can have the differences may be in geometric progression. If the differences are in geometric progression, same thing. You have to do the same, that SN you have to write, shift one term and subtract. Now in the bracket you will get GP. You know GP formula. You will use GP formula to simplify. So we will see in problems one example how to use this special progressions formulas. Actually, there is no formula. Some people will write, if the differences, see, let us go back to the same question. TN, what you got? 1 plus n minus 1 into n by 2 you got. 1 comma 2 comma 4 comma 7 comma 11. Since the differences are in arithmetic progression, its TN will be a quadratic. You can remember this. So what is T1 here in this progression? What is T1? T1 means A plus B plus C equal to 1. T2 means 4A plus 2B plus C equal to 2. T3 means 9A plus 3B plus C equal to 4. Enough. Because A, B, C, three terms have, three variables have to calculate, so three equations are enough. So subtract these two. What you will get, tell me? 3A plus B equal to 1. Subtract these two. 5A plus B equal to 2. Again subtract. You will get 2A equal to 1. A equal to 1 by 2. Then substitute A equal to 1 by 2 any one of the equation. You will get B value. Use A and B in any one of the equation, you will get C value. Take A, B, C and substitute in A n square plus B n plus C, you will get this directly. So, if differences are in either the AP or GP, the shifting and subtracting procedure is the best one. But if the difference in AP, you can use this facility that nth term, I'm telling nth term of that special progression will be a quadratic in N. And if you want to calculate Sn, sigma of Tn, you have to separate it. And as you know that sigma n is sigma n square, sigma n cube formulas, you know. Sigma n is how much? N into n plus 1 by 2. N square, sigma n square, n into n plus 1 into 2n plus 1 by 6. Sigma n cube, n square into n plus 1 whole square by 4. You have to use those to simplify. Then Vn minus 1 method. So here, by observing a given Tn in the question, we create Vn and Vn minus 1 so that we will create a relation between Tn and Vn minus 1. Then we'll apply sigma for Tn so that we can calculate Sn. Okay, this with the example, with the help of one problem, I will explain while discussing the problem. Just you remember what we do. We will, by seeing the Tn of the given question, we have to create Vn and Vn minus 1 so that if you do Vn minus Vn minus 1, some you can get a k which is independent of n into some Tn you can get. Then sigma Tn if you do, you can calculate Sn. So how to create Vn and Vn minus 1 is a very, very important task here. Weighted means. See, already you know that A1, A2, so on, An, let us say n numbers. Arithmetic mean is A1 plus A2 plus so on, An by n. Geometric mean is nth root of A1 into A2 into so on, An. Harmonic mean is n divided by 1 by A1 plus 1 by A2 plus so on plus 1 by An. Then what do you mean by weights? Suppose every element has some weights. See, in statistics, you will use these weights as frequencies. So here we are using the word weight. So arithmetic mean will be A1 W1 plus A2 W2 plus this we call as weighted mean. So weighted arithmetic mean, weighted geometric mean. So what you will get here? A1 W1. Can I say sigma AWI by W1 or sigma WI? Suppose if you want weighted geometric mean, it should be nth root of A1 power W1, A2 power W2, An power W. What is this capital N? Capital N is nothing but sigma WI. Similarly, weighted harmonic mean will be this capital N by W1 by A1 plus W2 by A2 plus so on WN by AN. So just try to understand, weights will be attached for that original formulas of means. Weights will be attached. Now, there is some very important inequality, Cauchy's inequality we can call, or Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. Before I tell that, I want to tell what is the arithmetic mean of nth powers of given numbers. Let us take A1, A2, so on, An are positive numbers, n positive numbers. Now what is A1 power m, A2 power m, so on An power m by n? What we call this as? Can I call this as arithmetic mean of mth powers of given numbers? Then right side I am writing a1 a plus a2 plus an by n whole power n. What is this? This is mth power of the arithmetic mean of given numbers. See the statement. LHS is arithmetic mean of mth powers. RHS is mth power of arithmetic mean. What is the relation between these two? The relation between these two is they will be equal if m value is either 0 or 1. Flower bracket. Suppose if m value is open interval 0 to 1, then it will be less than. If m value is minus infinity to 0, union 1 to infinity, it will be greater than. So, remember this property, that is called, that is not called Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, I will explain. Just you, this is the property called mth powers of arithmetic mean and arithmetic mean mth power. That is a relation between those two. Then what is Cauchy's inequality? Cauchy's inequality, we will relate two numbers. Suppose we have set of two numbers. Let us say a1, a2, so on, an, a set of n numbers. b1, b2, so on, bn, n numbers. Then Cauchy's inequality says that a1 b1 plus a2 b2 plus so on an bn whole square always less than or equals to a1 square plus a2 square plus an square into b1 square plus b2 square plus so on bn square. Bn square. I am repeating that a1, a2, so on, an, b1, b2, so on, bn, there are two sets of numbers. Then a1, b1 plus a2, b2 plus so on plus an, bn whole square is always less than or equals to a1 square plus a2 square plus so on, an square into b1 square plus b2 square plus so on, bn square. So can I say this right side is the maximum value of the left side? And that equality will hold, equality will hold, equality will hold, equality will hold if a1 by b1 equals to a2 by b2 equals to an by bn. This is called Cauchy's inequality. Okay, just you try to understand what it is, how to apply. We will do one problem later. These two inequalities are very, very important. Now, let us see some sigma notations. Here, I am not going to discuss problem. Sigma is a problem. So, students will understand sigma very easily. When it is a single sigma, suppose if I say sigma n, n equal to 1 to n, very clearly 1 plus 2 plus so on n. It's very easy. N into n plus 1 by 2. Then, suppose if I have double sigma, that is, I have double sigma like this, ij, 0 less than or equals to I less than j less than or equal to n. Suppose I have like this. What does it mean? What is the difference between this and suppose if I have sigma I equal to 1 to n, sigma j equal to 1 to n, ij. Let us discuss this. First, I want to explain you the second one. The second one can also be written as sigma I equals to 1 to n, of sigma j equal to 1 to n j means this here I will be there. So here we can say that I am using one important word. Actually sigma j equal to 1 to n ij was there, but I wrote I here. I shifted I here. This we will say I and j are independent. Whenever you have this type of structures, please remember I and j are independent. In this case, I and j are not independent. Not independent. So here, because I less than j also we are using, here I equal to 1 to n, j equal to 1 to n, ij. So ii shifted. So what is the meaning of this? How to expand this? So if you observe I equal to 1, it will take, then j will run from 1 to n, means 1 times 1 plus 2 plus up to n. Again plus, I will take 2, then j will go from 1 to n. So if you observe all this, all the numbers there, you can observe a matrix like this, 1 into 1, 1 into 2, 1 into 3, so on, 1 into n, 2 into 1, actually plus will be there in between, but I am writing as a matrix. So on, n into 1, plus n into 2, plus n into 3, plus so on, n into n. Yes, you, what I said, 1 times 1 plus 2 plus so on n, plus 2 times 1 plus 2 plus so on n. So if you expand and write, all the terms will be like this, and in between plus will be there. Then can I call this as the principal diagonal? 1 into 1, 2 into 2, 3 into 3, this is called principal diagonal. And you observe above the principal diagonal, I value will be less than j, and below the principal diagonal, I value will be greater than j. Means our previous discussion that I less than j, where I told I and j are not independent, I am talking about the above the principal diagonal element, that product I am asking. I am asking that product. Then how to evaluate that products? It is very easy to evaluate. Now suppose if I ask you what is sigma I equals to 1 to n I sigma j equal to 1 to n j, you know that this is can be written as ij also, double sigma ij also we can write. This is double sigma ij also we can write, I equal to 1 to n, j equal to 1 to n. So can I say this is nothing but sum of the terms in the upper triangle plus sum of the terms in the lower triangle plus sum of the terms in the diagonal. Okay, observe that sum of the terms in upper triangle and sum of the terms in the lower triangle, as per value they are not different, only commutative property. 1 into 2, here 2 into 1 will be there. There 1 into 3 will be there, here 3 into 1 will be there. So I can say sum of upper and sum of lower is nothing but 2 sigma sigma 0 less than or equal, because if 0 is also there, no problem. I less than j less than n or equal to n ij plus sigma ij I equal to j. So this is the relationship between ij when they are independent, when they are dependent. From this you can calculate whichever value you want. And suppose if I say this is sigma ij I equal to j, what is its meaning? Can I say like this, it is 1 square plus 2 square, because this principal diagonal 1 square plus 2 square plus so on n square, which is n into n plus 1 into 2n plus 1 by 6. Then what is LHS? LHS is nothing but what? This total, entire bracket sum, entire this matrix sum, 1 into 1 plus 2 into 2, is it nothing but 1 plus 2 plus so on up to n into 1 plus 2 plus up to n? Please try to expand this two brackets. Is it nothing but this matrix which you are going to develop? So can I say this is n square into n plus 1 whole square by 4, n into n plus 1 by 2 whole square. So you know this value, you know this value, you can calculate this value. So here my target is, you should understand what do you mean by double sigma. In the double sigma, how to distinguish when i and j are independent, when they are not independent. When they are independent, when they are not independent. And try to observe this matrix. From this, you can evaluate double sigma problems. Now let us discuss some basic points of straight lines. You know, coordinate system, distance between two points, section formulae, internal division, external division. Suppose I have ax1 y1, bx2 y2, cx3 y3. So what I want to do, I want to name not abc, which point is which also I don't want to care. There will be a starting point. I'm telling S as a starting point. There will be a dividing point. There will be a terminal point, another end point. Don't fix in your mind that dividing point is in middle of starting and terminal point. No. It may be like this: starting, terminal, dividing. Or it can be like this: starting, terminal, dividing. You know, one is internal division, one is external division. So my question is, what is the ratio dividing point will divide the line segment joining the starting point and terminal point? There are two formulae for that. I am storing the two formulae in single formula: starting minus dividing by dividing minus terminal. Just you remember this formula. And this formula, you can use x coordinates or y coordinates. Means you have two formulae in this. So I'm telling that, remember the formula like this: starting minus dividing, divided by dividing minus terminal. Starting minus dividing, divided by dividing minus terminal. Either you can use x coordinates or y. What do you mean by use x coordinates or y coordinates? Starting point x coordinate minus dividing point x coordinate. By dividing point means you can suffix x here, or you can suffix y. So remember, there will be two formulas. So you can use two formulas to calculate the ratio in which the dividing point is dividing the line segment joining the starting point and terminal point. So if these two ratios are, means by x and by y, whatever ratio I am getting, If they are not equal, remember that this division is not taking place. Means the three points are not collinear. If really they are collinear, if you use x coordinates or y coordinates, this ratio should become same. Next, harmonic conjugates. So what do you mean by harmonic conjugates? So harmonic conjugates means Suppose you have a line segment AB. You have a line segment AB. This is point A, this is point B. Suppose there is a point C which is dividing in the ratio M is to N internally. And there is another point D which is dividing, D is dividing. See, C is dividing the line segment AB internally. D is dividing the line segment AB in the same ratio M is to N, but externally. Then, the C comma D are called, C comma D are called harmonic conjugates or harmonic conjugate points of the line segment AB. The line segment AB. When C is nearer to A, the internal point, the external point also nearer, it should be nearer to A. Suppose I am taking a diagram like this. A, B, C, D. Assume, forget about the diagram, reality. What I want to say you is, if AC is the line segment, B and D are the harmonic conjugates. Then remember, AB, AC, AD. These three distances will form harmonic progression. So 2 by AC will be equals to, 2 by AC will be equals to, what is the condition? What should be the condition? What is the harmonic mean formula? Just now we revised, you know. Two by AC equals to 1 by AB plus 1 by AD. Please remember, B and D are the harmonic conjugate points of AC line segment. And one more important thing I want to tell you. If B and D are harmonic conjugates for the line segment AC, for the line segment BD, the points C and A are also harmonic conjugates. Just try to remember the meaning of harmonic conjugates. For every line segment, there is one point which is dividing internally. There is another point which is dividing externally in the same ratio. Then these two points are called harmonic conjugates of the given line segment. It can't be a midpoint, because midpoint cannot be, 1:1 ratio cannot be external. So other than midpoint, for every point, there exists a harmonic conjugate. That is the meaning of harmonic. So here my meaning of these symbols is, O means ortho center, N means 9-point circle center, G means centroid, S means circumcenter, I means in center, I1, I2, I3 are the X centers. So let us start with simple point, which is centroid. You know, median's concurrency point. So if join a vertex to the midpoint of opposite side, it will be median. Three medians are concurrent and the point of concurrency is called centroid. Centroid divides each median in the ratio 2:1 from vertex side. Suppose if it is AX1, Y1, BX2, Y2, CX3, Y3, centroid will be X1 plus X2 plus X3 by 3, comma Y1 plus Y2 plus Y3 by 3. You should create such a ratio. See, all of you. What is the D coordinates? X2 plus x3 by 2, y2 plus y3 by 2. So x by 1, x1 by 1, y1 by 1, and D coordinates are x2 plus x3 by 2, comma y2 plus y3 by 2. So if I choose 2:1 ratio, then there is a symmetricity in getting G, because G lies on AD as well as BE as well as CF. That's why the ratio should be in such a way. Observe carefully, this sentence is very important. The ratio should be in such a way, if I apply that internal ratio formula on AD or BE or CF, same formula we should get. So that is the logic behind creating this ratio 2:1. That is about centroid. Then what is orthocenter? From vertex, if you draw a perpendicular, it is called altitude. Altitude divides the opposite side in the ratio tan C is to tan B. D divides in the ratio tan C is to tan B. That's why if you choose x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3, D you can write tan C x3 plus tan B x2 by tan C plus tan B, comma tan C y3 plus tan B y2 divided by tan C plus tan B. So by writing all altitudes feats formulas, similarly how I discussed in the centroid, which ratio if we choose, you will get same formula for orthocenter. If you observe, you will get orthocenter formula as x1 tan A plus x2 tan B plus x3 tan C by tan A plus tan B plus tan C. So similarly, you can write y coordinate. Similarly, you can tell circumcenter, and circumcenter formula will be x1 sin 2A plus x2 sin 2B plus x3 sin 2C by sin 2A plus sin 2B plus sin 2C. Similarly, y coordinate you can write. And 9-point circle center, I think everybody know. ABC. If you take O as the orthocenter, just join AO, BO, CO, midpoints of AO, BO, CO, and midpoints of the sides, and feet of the altitudes. So those 9 points will be concyclic. Its center is called 9-point circle center. In properties of triangles, you can find 9-point circle center, circumradius, all those things. Then you know incenter. Incenter is the internal angular bisectors. A concurrent internal angular bisectors are concurrent, and the point of concurrency is called incenter. If A is BC, B is CA, and C is AB, lengths of the sides, then incenter formula is AX1 plus BY1, AX1 plus BX2 plus CX3 by A plus B plus C. Similarly, Y coordinate you can write. Because same thing, same application you will have. You know that internal angular bisector divides the opposite side in the ratio of other two sides. B is to C, C is to B. So it will be CX3 plus BX2 by C plus B. Similarly, what I discussed in centroid, you have to choose a ratio in such a way that on whatever angular bisector you apply, you should get the same formula. By that symmetricity, if you observe, you will get the ratio as well as the formula. And you know that incenter divides in the ratio B plus C is to A internally. And suppose if you take a triangle, take one internal angle, and two external angles. This is called X center. Similarly, you can get all the three X centers, I1, I2, I3. And I1 will be what I told, I divides internal angular bisector of A internally. I1 divides externally in the same ratio. B plus C is to A. B plus C is to A. So can I say I and I1 are harmonic conjugates for AD? I and I1 are harmonic conjugates of AD. That's why I1 what I will get? External no minus AX1 plus BX2 plus CX3 by minus A plus B plus C. Similarly, I2, I3. So for I2, AX1 minus BX2 you will get. Here A minus B plus C you will get. For I3, AX1 plus BX2 minus CX3. So for I1, A will have minus sign. For I2, B will have minus sign. For I3, C will have minus sign. They are harmonic conjugates. Now, thing, area of polygon I have to discuss. But in any triangle, please remember, there is a called Euler's line. O, N, G, S will be in the ratio 3:1:2. Means they will be collinear in this ratio. You observe all of you, OG as a line segment. OG as a line segment. N is dividing in what ratio? 3:1. Same OG line segment. S is dividing externally in total OS is to SG. See, always starting point to dividing point is 6. Is to dividing point to end point. That is 2x. So which is again 3:1. So can I say N is dividing internally? S is dividing externally? So this N and S are called harmonic conjugates of OG. So this is called Euler's line. And what is area of parallel, area of polygon? So if you are given the vertices x1, y1, x2, y2, so on xn, yn as the vertices of polygon, area is given as half modulus of det vertex 1, vertex 2, so on vertex, last vertex, and repeat the first vertex. All downward multiplications minus all upward multiplications means half modulus of x1 y2 plus x2 y3 so on minus x2 y1 plus so on means all sum of all downwards minus sum of all upwards. If it is triangle, quadrilateral, anything, if vertices are given, you can use this formula to find area of the polygon. So locus, you know what you mean by locus. So locus is a path traced by a set of points. Path traced by set of points which satisfy a given condition. It is called locus. So there are some simple locus. Suppose if you say PA equal to PB, you should understand A and B are two fixed points, P is a moving point. It should be a perpendicular locus, is a perpendicular bisector. So PA plus PB equal to K. If K equal to AB, so AB, P must be an internally dividing point. If K greater than AB, this K value means P must be outside like this, then locus will be ellipse. If K is less than AB, no locus. So like this, just I am revising some points. You may be finding these things in your notes or any standard book. PA minus PB equals to K. Let us take modulus. Same AB. Suppose if P, K, this K value is AB, P will be externally dividing point. Externally dividing point. If K is less than AB, then AB, K will be less than AB means P will form hyperbola. If K greater than AB, there won't be any locus. There won't be any locus. So suppose A and B is a line segment. At P, they are making 90 degrees. So you can be, you will be given AP square plus BP square equal to AB square. Then locus of P will be a circle with AB as the diameter. AB as diameter. So like this, you have some standard locus. Similarly, if you have second degree non-homogeneous equation, AX square plus 2HXY plus BY square plus 2GX plus 2FY plus C. You know there is a discriminant called ABC plus 2FGH minus AF square minus BG square minus CH square. If this discriminant is equals to 0, what it is? It is pair of straight lines. If it is not equal to 0 and h square equals to AB, parabola. And you know that if A equal to B and h equal to 0, it represents circle. If delta not equal to 0, h square is equal to AB, parabola. H square less than AB, ellipse. H square greater than AB, hyperbola. I think all these things are the basic things which you know. So change of axis, you know, shifting of origin. So small x, capital X plus H, small y, capital Y plus K, where XY is old coordinates, capital letters are new coordinates, H comma K is new origin. So in the given second degree non-homogeneous equation, if you want to remove x and y coordinates, the point you have to shift origin is hf minus bg by ab minus h square, gh minus af by ab minus h square. So these are the standard results you know. Now, if axes are rotated through an angle theta in the anticlockwise direction, there is a table, you can remember the table, or you can use old coordinates equals to new coordinates into sys theta. You can use rotation sys theta formula, and back if you want, you can get new equals to old minus old into sys of minus theta, because when you do rotation in the clockwise direction, what you will get? Sys of minus theta you have to multiply. When you are rotating to in the anticlockwise direction, you multiply with sys of theta. So how to remember that point? Like this, can I say x plus iy equal to capital X plus iy into sys theta? Capital X plus IY should be equal to X plus IY. If you shift sys theta that side, sys of minus theta. Or I think you have a table also. XY cos theta sin theta minus sin theta cos theta. It's your wish. You can use any one. Either use complex numbers or you can use this matrix also. So you have different forms of straight lines, and in that slope point form, intercept form, normal form, symmetric form, parametric form. So parametric form is very, very important form. Parametric form says you that suppose if there is a straight line x1, y1, it's passing through and its inclination is theta, then x equals to x1 plus r cos theta, y equal to y1 plus r sin theta. These are called parametric form. And the speciality is here, mod r will be under root of x minus x1 whole square plus y minus y1 whole square. So try to understand parametric point, parametric what it will do. It generates the points for different values of r. So r, if you go on giving any real number, it generates the point on the straight line, given straight line, at a distance of mod r units. The speciality is, suppose if you give r equal to 5, it generates, see, r is nothing but, mod r is nothing but 5 now. So r will be plus r minus 5. Means you will be generating two points at 5 unit distance from the given point x1, y1. So if you give a value for r, this parametric equations will generate a point on the line. What is the speciality of generated point? It will be at a distance of whatever parameter you are giving, modulus of that parameter distance from the given point. So parametric form always generates the points in the locus, whereas non-parametric forms will check whether the given point is in the locus or not. So parametric forms will use in generating the points, in generating the required points. And one more thing is normal form. Normal form conversion, I think everybody know. Ax plus by plus c equal to 0. So if c is negative, you will shift c that side so that minus will become positive. Then you will divide with a square plus b square root over a square plus b square. Then this right side becomes the perpendicular distance from origin. If c is positive, it will be c by. So what is the perpendicular distance from origin to any straight line? Ax plus by plus c mod c by root over a square plus b square. What is the perpendicular distance from any point? So can I say modulus of ax1 plus by1 plus c by root over a square plus b square? Suppose if I take this ax plus by plus c as L, can I call this as L1? Modulus of L11 by root over a square plus b square. L11 means, my meaning is substituting the point x1, y1 in L. Not L equal to 0. L means only this part. That is perpendicular distance. There is a line L. Ax plus by plus c equal to 0. There is a line segment A x1, y1, b x2, y2. L is dividing AB line segment. Dividing means it can divide it internally or externally. So the ratio is minus L11 by L22. So L11 means substituting x1 by 1 in L. L22 means substituting x2 by 2 in L. So with this you will get. Now if the ratio is positive, if the ratio is positive, it will be internal division. If it is negative, ratio is negative. Means, can I say like this now? When the ratio will be positive, L11, L22 should have opposite sign. Then when the ratio is positive, it will be internal division. If it is internal division, the figure will be like this. Means points will be opposite side. See, remember like this. If L is there, two points are there. Let us calculate L11, L22. L11, L22. If they have opposite sign, they will have opposite side. If L11, L22 have same sign, if they have same sign, this minus sign will be as it is, then the ratio will be negative. Therefore, the points will be on the same side because the division will be AB will be like this, the straight line will be like this, the dividing will be external. So when L11, L22 opposite signs, points will be opposite side. When L11, L22 same sign, the points will be on the same side. This is the ratio in which a line divides the lines. Family of congruent lines. You know that suppose L1 equal to 0, L2 equal to 0 are two lines. Lambda 1 L1 plus Lambda 2 L2 equal to 0, where Lambda 1, Lambda 2 are parameters, represents a family of concurrent lines if L1 and L2 are intersecting lines. If L1 and L2 are parallel lines, Lambda 1 L1 plus Lambda 2 L2 equal to 0 also represents set of parallel lines. But as we are discussing concurrent lines, suppose L1, L2 are two lines like this, they are concurrent, intersected. Then Lambda 1 L1 plus Lambda 2 L2 equal to 0. Well, Lambda 1, Lambda 2 at a time cannot be zeros. So which is not equal to 0 with that? Assume that Lambda 1 not equal to 0. I will divide with Lambda 1. Then Lambda 2 by Lambda 1, let us take some Lambda. This is the simplest form of family of concurrent lines. So L1 plus Lambda L2 equal to 0 always represents a family of concurrent lines with the point of concurrency as the point of intersection of L1 and L2. Angular bisectors. You know angular bisectors. Suppose A1x plus B1y plus C1 equal to 0, A2x plus B2y plus C2 equal to 0 are two lines. Then angular bisectors A1x plus B1y plus C1 by under root of A1 square plus B1 square, perpendicular distance, that modulus I am removing, then you will get plus or minus both sides. A2x plus B2y plus C2 by root over A2 square plus B2 square. Because angular bisectors definition is locus of the points which are equidistant from arms of the angle. So the perpendicular distances I am equating, I got the locus. So if I take plus sign, I will get one angular bisector. If I take minus sign, I will get another angular bisector. Those are the two angular bisectors. Now suppose in that lines, in the given lines, first C1 and C2, I will make it C1 comma C2, I will make positives. Means if they are negatives, I will take minus sign, I will make them positives. After making them positives, you will get two equations. Same formula, perpendicular distance you apply, plus or minus. Now in these brackets, you will write new equations, not old equations. After making C1, C2 positives, whatever new equations you will have, those equations you will use in writing this. Then plus sign if you take, you will get angular bisector of the angle containing origin. If you take minus, not containing origin you will get. So what do you mean by containing origin and not containing origin? Suppose you have coordinate system like this, let us say. So if you have alpha this angle, beta this is the angle. So you note that this will be alpha, this will be beta. So origin is here. So can I say the angular bisector of alpha is the angular bisector containing origin? Angular bisector of beta angle is the angular bisector not containing origin. So to get the angular bisector which contains origin, which does not contain origin, this is the procedure. First in the given equations, make C1, C2 positives, use this property. Suppose A1x plus B1y plus C1 equal to 0, A2x plus B2y plus C2 equal to 0 are two straight lines. If A1, A2 plus B1, B2 equal to 0, you know that they are perpendicular to each other. Assume that A1, A2 plus B1, B2 not equals to 0. Then either you can have positive plus negative minus. Means A1, A2 plus B1, B2 can be greater than 0 or less than 0. Then you use the angular bisectors formula. plus r minus, you will get two angular bisectors. Then here there is no necessity to make C1, C2 positive. Some textbooks will write C1, C2 make positives. No need. Just in the given, you calculate A1, A2 plus B1, B2 values. That's it. If you use positive, you will get obtuse angular bisector. If you get negative, if you use minus sign, you will get obtuse. So I am explaining only how to get obtuse angular bisector. So to get obtuse angular bisector, calculate A1, A2 plus B1, B2 value. If its value is positive, and in the formula, if you use plus sign, positive, positive. Remember like that. If A1, A2 plus B1, B2 is positive, use positive sign, you will get obtuse angular bisector. If A1, A2 plus B1, B2 is negative, use minus sign to get obtuse. So automatically, other acute angular bisector will be developed. Sir, what happens if C1, C2 made positive? If you make positive and use this property also, property won't change. But you will get extra feature. What you will get after making C1, C2 positive, if you use those new equations, you know that if you use plus, you will get containing origin. So in that case, you can link acute angular bisector, means origin lies in the acute angle or obtuse angle also, you can confirm. So optimization, very important concept. Suppose I have two points A and B, let us say, and there is a line AX plus BY plus C equal to 0. Suppose the question is, I want a point P such that on the line AX plus BY plus C equal to 0, that should be on the line, so that PA plus PB is maximum or minimum. So what I am saying, A and B are on the same side of a line. I want PA plus PB maximum. Suppose I want PA plus PB maximum. So suppose if I take P here, I will join AB. I will extend. Suppose if I take P here, then PA plus PB, you will get one value. It's a straight line, no? If I choose P far from AB, I will get PA plus PB more maximum. So in this situation, PA plus PB maximum, to have PA plus PB maximum, we can't get P because it's an infinite straight line, means infinite. P can be find anywhere, so that PA plus PB maximum never ends. So when A and B are on the same side of a straight line, PA plus PB maximum, to have PA plus PB maximum, we cannot find P on the line AX plus BY plus C equal to 0. But suppose if I ask you in this situation, PA plus PB, I want minimum. PA plus PB, I want minimum. You know that PA plus PB, sum of two sides of a triangle is always greater than the third side. PA plus PB minimum, if PA and PB are, that ABP must be collinear and P must be internally dividing point. But in this situation, it's not possible. Then what to do? Observe carefully. This is very, very important. Suppose you have A here, somewhere B here, you have to find P on the line, so that PA plus PB is minimum. Then what you should do? Let us calculate image of A, some A dash with respect to the line. So this is image of A with respect to this line AX plus BY plus C. Then what do you do? This A dash and B you join. it intersects the given line at P. Then, observe carefully. Our question was PA plus PB must be minimum. As A and A dash are images to each other, this line 1 will be the perpendicular bisector of AA dash. So, PA value and PA dash will be equal. These two will be equal. Then, can I say this is a point where PB plus PA dash you are telling, but it is nothing but PA only. That's why P is the point, you are the collinearity point, so that you will get minimum value. This is the point P where you will get PA plus PB minimum. Where you will get PA plus PB minimum. Now suppose you have same situations. I will take A, B are on the same side of a line, line 1 let us say. Now I want to see PA minus PB. A and B are on the same side, PA minus PB I want to discuss. Now since they are on the same side, PA minus PB, if you want minimum, can you have minimum? If they are on the same side of line, can you have PA minus PB minimum? When you have PA minus PB minimum, you can't have, because again the same problem, minimum is not possible. Suppose if I ask you PA minus PB maximum when it is possible, very simple, you join AB and extend it to cut. Suppose let us take A here, B here, join AB and extend it to cut. See PA, PB, what is the difference? AB is the difference. You know the difference of two sides is always lesser than the third side. Lesser than the third side. Third side is nothing but AB. It will be maximum if they are equal. Means PA minus PB, or difference between PA and PB, you will have maximum if they are collinear again. That's why if they are on the same side, just extend it to cut the given line. That is a required point where your PA minus PB will be maximum. So what I discussed in the previous, I discussed if A and B are on the same side of a line 1, when PA plus PB will be minimum maximum, when PA minus PB will be minimum maximum, I discussed. Now suppose if A is like this and B is like this, what is this? A and B are on the opposite sides of 1 now. A and B are on the opposite sides. Suppose if I join them, then P will be internally dividing point. Now what will happen? PA plus PB minimum point, that is. Same logic. Sum of two sides will be always greater than the third side. Greater than the third side. That's why if they are collinear, you will get the minimum value. And the PA plus PB maximum value does not exist, because I can choose P anywhere to make PA plus PB maximum. Current situation is, suppose A and B are on the opposite side. A and B are on the opposite sides of a line 1. Then how to get PA minus PB? PA minus PB minimum maximum values. Tell me which exists, which does not exist. PA minus PB minimum does not exist. What about maximum? Maximum is very simple. Suppose B, you get B dash, which is the image of B. Then join A, B dash and extend it to cut at P. Same logic. Because PB will be equal to PB dash. So collinearity point you are choosing. So PA minus PB maximum point will be there. So observe this carefully. You will understand very easily. Then the last concept is pair of straight lines. You know that you can combine two straight lines to get pair of straight lines. And ax square plus 2hxy plus by square equals to 0 always represents a pair of straight lines passing through origin. If x square is less than ab, the lines will be imaginary. The point of intersection will be origin, real point of intersection with imaginary pair of lines. If h square is greater than or equals to ab, always it represents pair of straight lines. And you know that non-homogeneous equations ax square plus 2hxy plus by square plus 2gx plus 2fy plus c equal to 0 represents a pair of straight lines if delta equal to 0, discriminant I discussed already, discriminant equal to 0. You have pair of parallel lines, distance between pair of parallel lines, all those things you have to learn. Suppose you have a curve, thus s equal to 0 is a curve, ax square plus 2hx square plus by square plus 2gx plus 2fy plus c equal to 0. A line is intersecting that curve. A line is intersecting that curve. Let us say that line L equal to 0. So AX plus BY, or you take LX plus MY, LX plus MY plus N equal to 0. So this any point on this line will satisfy this condition, LX plus MY by minus N equal to 1. But these two points will satisfy the line as well as the curve. That's why if I do ax square plus 2hxy plus by square plus 2gx plus 2fy into this lx plus my by minus n plus c into lx plus my by minus n whole square equal to 0. Now suppose if these two points are a and b, if I substitute a, these values will become 1. Then you will be left over with the curve equation. Listen carefully, I am telling. Suppose if I substitute point A in this new equation. Observe the new equation what I did. Second degree terms I did not touch. First degree term I multiplied this 1. And the constant I multiplied 1 square. What happened for this? I did something to get a homogeneous equation. So this is a homogeneous equation which I got. What is the speciality of that homogeneous equation? You know that every homogeneous equation should represent a pair of straight lines passing through origin. Along with that, I am observing one more thing. If I substitute A, this Lx plus My by minus N will become 1 and it will become the curve equation on which A is there. Means A will satisfy this new equation also. Similarly, B also satisfies the new equation. So, by doing this process, what I did, I developed a homogeneous equation which is passing through A and B. Means I developed a pair of straight lines which is passing through origin. This is called homogenization. This process is called homogenization. So, very long discussion we had. With the help of this, we will solve problems. Thank you.